the talent, the looks, the voice. For moviegoers in the 1940s, Lauren Bacall had it all. And if that wasn't enough, she also had Humphrey Bogart, Hollywood's ultimate couple. They met on the set of the classic 1944 film To Have and Have Not. Aged just 19, Bacall had won the part after being spotted on the front of Harper's Bazaar magazine by the wife of the film's director, Howard Hawks. Her performance caused a sensation, making her an international star overnight. Even decades later, the chemistry between her and Bogart would fascinate an interviewer like Michael Parkinson.
The core of the story is of a young New York Jewish girl who dreamed of being a star and became one at the age of 18 when Howard Hawks cast her alongside Humphrey Bogart in a film called To Have and Have Not. And he created something which became known as The Look, unwittingly starting one of Hollywood's great love stories and manufacturing a moment of cinema that's as fresh today as when it happened 35 years ago.
Anybody got a match? Thanks.
I wish you hadn't mentioned how many years ago it was, Michael.
It was 35 years ago, wasn't it?
But I was only 35 years ago.
Was that contrived, the look, or was it accidental?
Well, it was a result of my nerves, which if you look very closely, you might see again, that I used to shake so much that my head used to shake. And, you know, when in a film, when a director says action, there's dead silence on a set. So all eyes are on you, and everything depends upon you. And I was such a nervous wreck that I discovered finally that one way to hold my head still was to hold it down. And then the back of my neck got so stiff that nothing would move and look up. And that became the look. But it was that combined with Howard Hawks's terrific eye and knowing that if the camera were in a certain position and there were shadows in the right place, which I could do with right now, as a matter of fact. It was a combination of, yeah, of what he saw, yeah, and my panic.
But how much of what came over, that sultry, sexy, sort of worldly look, was the real you at that time?
None of it.
No, because you were in fact 18,
I mean,
weren't
what,
you?
What can you be, you know, when you're 18 years old and you know nothing, and you have no very limited acting experience, almost none, and very little life experience. I mean, how sophisticated can you be for heaven's sake?
Yeah.
But if you have a deep voice and Howard Hawks writes your dialogue and directs you and,
yes,
and lights you correctly, and I mean, you can be anything.
What was charming about your book, actually, about your early years, was this obsession that you had about becoming a film star.
Yeah.
I mean, you were really starstruck, weren't you, from an early age?
But I didn't really want to be a film star. I really wanted to be on the stage.
On the stage.
But I wanted my name in lights. I wanted that dream. I don't know where I got it from, because, as you know from the book, no one in my family even came close to being in the theater.
Yeah.
Or anything in the entertainment world. And I was just... I don't know, I just had to do it, and I would have done anything, almost anything, and I did almost anything, to be recognized.
You say, of course, that your first ambition was to go on the stage, but in fact, your great heroine at the time, the person you watched, was a film star, wasn't she?
Well, of course, because I mean, films were accessible to me. Right. I mean, when I was a kid, it was about 20 cents to get into a movie house. I mean, to go to the theater was just so expensive, I could never possibly have afforded that. Mm.
Did you think that you had the proper physical attributes at the time when you were 16, 17, to become a film star?
Michael, you know I didn't. I was flat-chested and large of foot and very gawky. No, I didn't. And I thought, I mean, I always was shy about smiling because my teeth were crooked and God, I don't know. I was a mess. I don't know how many of this ever happened.
And because, I mean, you had the looks. I mean, you can't have been as bad looking as all that because you became a sort of a very famous model in America, didn't you? Which is how you got into...
Yes, but that was luck. And that was, I mean, also, you know, if you're photographed by the right person at the right time, the right way, you look okay.
Yeah.
I don't say I was ugly, but I was sure no raving beauty, I'll tell you.
You, in the book, the most fascinating chapters, and the best written, in my view, are the ones which you recount your...
Careful.
..relationship, no, with Bogey. It is quite... It's a centrepiece of the book. And obviously the man had a profound and lasting effect on your life.
Absolutely.
And I'm delighted that I remember the last time that you came on my show, you said that being a widow is not a profession, and you didn't like talking about that part of your life, but you've written about it beautifully well, actually. And what comes across, actually, about the man is that he was a rare man. I mean, in that town, he was a very uncompromising character, and that must be very, very difficult to have been that, to maintain that stance.
Right, to be honest.
Yeah.
In a town that is full of hello, darling, and icing on the cake, you know, saying that everything is wonderful and all the films that are wonderful, it was very difficult to tell the truth. Most people in Hollywood really did not want to hear the truth, if it was negative.
Yes.
I mean, only positive. Yes. And Bogey, of course, didn't understand that. He was incapable of telling a lie. He really was.
Yes. How difficult did he find it, though, to live with the screen image that he had of being the tough man, the hard man?
Well, I mean, that is something that... I mean, there's nothing you can do to erase an image. Once you have made a hit in a role, in a certain kind of role in films, there is no way to lose that identity. I mean, people just see you that way.
Mm.
And of course, in New York, you go to a nightclub or even a restaurant for dinner, and some drunk would walk over and say, "Ashley, you think you're tough, huh? You know, give him a..." And he would just turn around, and if he'd had a couple of drinks, he'd say, "Yeah." I mean, he'd start playing the part, which had nothing to do with him whatever. Just leading him up to the brink, you know. He was terrific at brinksmanship, I mean, until the moment when the guy was ready to punch him, because then Bogey would start laughing, because he knew that if it came to fisticuffs, that was out of the question, that he couldn't fight his way out of a paper bag, so he just...
How difficult did you find it also for yourself? Because you were creating an image, weren't you, from your very first film. How difficult was it for you to get rid of it, live up to...
Well, I've had that problem all my life, I mean, all my professional life, that people have seen me in a certain way. I think I make that very clear in the book, right. Even... including today, that I am looked upon as a woman who's in total control and command of every situation, that I don't need anyone, and that I've got all the answers, and it's all very sharp, you know, just like all those parts I played. Well, as we all know, no one's that sure of themselves, I don't think. And if they are, I don't want to meet them. I mean, it's very tough to just walk into any room privately and have someone decide what you're all about.
Are you nervous because you know what to expect, their reaction to you when you get in there? Or are you nervous because you don't know what the reaction will be?
Walking into a room?
Yes, what I'm saying is that, I mean...
Well, I'm nervous. I don't know. I'm just nervous. I don't know.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't analyze it. It's just that it's... I suppose in our society, it's becoming less difficult all the time, but it is not easy to walk into a room by yourself.
Mm.
And it is twice as difficult if you walk into a room and people have preconceived notions of what you are.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, I'm immediately on the defensive, and so I have to live up to that.
What's interesting, actually, in the book also is that the conflict that's run right through your life about whether or not you marry and devote yourself to a man, or whether you go on with a career. And it seemed to me that you always took the option for companionship for the man.
Yes,
rather than
but
your...
that's over.
That's over.
I'm
now,
not
is
doing
it?
That anymore.
You're not?
Michael. No. I don't believe... You can never say never, because there's no such thing as I'll never do anything again. And who knows, I'll turn around tomorrow and some fascinating creature will drop from heaven and that'll be it. But I don't expect that to happen. I just... I will feel better, I think, just concentrating on work, friends, whatever happens. I'm very open to everything. But I love to work, and I really think work is the most important thing in life. Yes. I think using oneself is more important than anything.
Yes.
Being aware and awake and knowing what's going on.
At the end of the book, actually, you say something very interesting. Toward the end of the book, you say that now you've written all about yourself, that you found out that you don't like everything I know about myself. What don't you?
No.
You don't specify, though, you see. And I wonder what it was that you...
Well, I have faced... when you start reviewing your life, you have to face your shortcomings. And you can't just shove them under the rug anymore. I don't like moments of envy that I have.
Professionally, yes.
Mm-hmm. I don't like... I don't admire at all in myself the my not having the courage to stand up to Hawks every time he made a crack about the Jews. I don't feel good about that. It took me many years before I could deal with that.
Hmm.
Many years. It was very, very difficult.
Was there much anti-Semitism?
It wasn't that. It was just that each time every one thing would happen. I mean, they made such a to-do about it because of the fact that in their eyes I didn't look Jewish, and so they were so stunned. I can't believe it. Can you believe that's true? Look at that girl. She doesn't look, you know. And so that I always felt that I was singled out and set apart and that I had additional obstacles to overcome. It became a weight around my neck.
Yes.
And I hated the fact that I felt that.
Yes. You felt you had to go to people beforehand because you didn't look Jewish and say, by the way, I am Jewish, just in case.
Well, I did to Bogey.
You did?
But I didn't professionally. And that is what I don't like about myself, the fact that I did not say, now, just a minute, you may as well know it now, and we'll stand. I mean, I wasn't that terrific. I was not that gutsy, and I wasn't that honest about it. I was terrified that maybe I would lose my job, and I didn't have the courage to deal with it.
What about now? Do you still feel, you know, uneasy when somebody makes an anti-Semitic remark in your company?
I do, of
you
course
do.
I do.
Do you now, though?
Well, now, I mean, now, it's out, folks. I mean, forget it.
Is it?
Now,
it's knives to draw.
No, I mean, I don't know. But it's so much pleasanter to just not have to... Why should I have to worry about my religion? I mean, that's so... It has nothing to do with what anybody is. I mean, it's what you... I mean, you're born the way you're born, and you live the way you live.
Hmm.
And I don't... Why should I be judged for something that... I mean, when people don't know me?
The other interesting thing, that conclusion you come to, is to do with your age. And to do with particularly the...
Oh, you always do this to me.
No, I don't. I don't. No, it's
you did it last time. Don't you remember when I dropped the lighter? You said something about my... Something about...
No, that wasn't me. That was another interviewer.
Okay, press on.
You made the remark, and it's absolutely true, that in American society particularly, that a woman of 26 is reckoned to be professionally and every other way on the downward slope.
On the skids.
Mm. yes, really. I mean, and that can't give you any great comfort.
No.
That,
that also is the understatement of the century.
Yeah.
No, it doesn't give me any great comfort, but I will fight to the death my right to work.
No, absolutely. No, but it's...
But not to be judged. I hate the fact that there's a number next to everybody's name.
That's right.
That puts you in a certain category. Right. I mean, there are people of 40 that are ancient. I mean, I know a man, one of the men that I was involved with in my book, who was 15 years my junior, who's too old for me, I'll tell you that.
But, I mean, how much are you swimming against the tide in that field?
Well, I think that categorizing has always existed, and I think it is. I think it also does exist here to a degree.
Oh, surely, absolutely.
And, you know, there's a number next to your name here right. as well. And what is it? Is it the Times where they were always saying today's your birthday, and you're wonderful to announce that to the world? Who needs that?
Yes, yes.
But I think to be judged that you are a certain way because you are 30 or 40 or 50 or 60 is totally unfair, and why should we be so limited? Why should age confine us and make us unable to spread our wings? I mean, to play, if you're an actor, to play different kinds of parts or whatever.
It's particularly...
Why do you have to retire because somebody says that you've reached 62 and you must retire?
But women women particularly are vulnerable to this kind of thinking, aren't they?
Yes, but I think it's affected men as well.
Yes.
I think men that have been asked or feel that they must retire from a job that they've held for 20 years because they've reached an age, a certain age, and don't want to retire and are not ready to retire mentally or physically or anyway, I mean, it certainly affects them badly.
Retirement was never an option for Bacall. But she's always been frank about the fickle nature of fame and the pressure it brings, as she explains here in an interview with Barry Norman.
It's terrible to be 18 or 19 years old and have that kind of success when you are not prepared for it, when you are not equipped to deal with it, as I had had very little experience, acting experience. I mean, I wanted to be an actress and I studied for it, but I still had not done it enough. I mean, how much can you do by that age, you know? Not a hell of a lot. So, and that kind of insanity that goes on, when you make that kind of an instant success, which is partially real, but also partially created by studio people then, you know. Warner Brothers had, as head of publicity, a man called Charlie Einfeld, who was one of the great publicity geniuses of all time. And he knew how to really make somebody, everyone talk about you. And I mean, I was in every magazine, on every cover, on everything. Too much. I remember arriving at Grand Central Station in New York from California just after To Have and Have Not had been released. And Grand Central Station was packed with fans and police. Thousands and thousands of people. Now, I don't know how they got there. Somebody from Warner Brothers must have spread the word. I have no idea how it happened. But I mean, when that happens to a 19-year-old girl, it's very scary. You just don't understand it.
And were you expected to react in this slightly cynical, slightly tough, slightly wisecracking way that you appear in the film?
I have no idea.
By the time you made The Big Sleep, you and Humphrey Bogart were married.
By the time it was released, we were.
Now, what influence did he have on your career and indeed on teaching you to act? Did he try to teach you or did he encourage you to go your own way?
He never tried to. I mean, he never gave me acting lessons. He never interfered in my career at all. He never tried to get me a part. He never threw his weight around at all on my behalf. He felt that should be a separate thing. He occasionally, I remember once in The Big Sleep, it's very funny, there was a scene where the doorbell rang and there was a shot of me coming out of a room to go and answer the door, you see. So we had a rehearsal of the scene for the camera. And Howard Hawks yelled, you know, called action. And I walked out of this door to presumably my bedroom, to answer the front door. And before we did the take, Bogey took me to one side and said, "You walked out of that room like a model." He said, "Always remember that you've come from somewhere."
Are you sure that she's coming?
Oh, yeah, she'll be all right in the morning.
Did you do this?
That? Oh, yes, that's a little special service I always provide all my clients.
Including being insolent.
And that was, I suppose, that was one of the things that made me aware that one must always think before the take, that you don't wait to think once the cameras start to roll. You have to start to think before that, so that you know that something has preceded it, so that you're not a puppet, really.
When you look back now on those, your early part of your life in Hollywood, does it seem real or does it seem like something that happened to somebody else whom you knew?
It seems very much as though it happened to somebody else. I mean, I know it happened to me. But as I think of me then, it doesn't seem like me. I mean, I don't relate to it. I don't think about that life, except occasionally when I think, did I really live like that? I mean, was that really me living in that house? I mean, I remember experiencing all of it, and I remember being in all of the places that I was and with the people that I was, but it's so far from the way I've lived for the last 15 years.
I get the impression that after Bogart's death, your career never quite reached the same heights again. Now, is that true? And if so, is it coincidental? Or was it simply because of the way the film industry was going?
I think it's a very gracious way of putting it. On your part, actually. It never reached the heights again, and it never will, and that's it. And nobody cared, is what it really amounted to, except me. No, I think... You see, I was never... I don't think I was considered by a lot of people in films as an actress. I was thought of as Bogey's wife by a lot of people. Oh, that terrific girl, Bogey's wife, you know, and that was it. No one ever thought that I cared that much about work, I don't think. I mean, you don't go around saying, I want to work, I care about... Oh, hello. it just... They were still making films, and they were making good films, but they didn't want me in them. And, you know, I mean, when something... I do find in life that when something devastating happens, it happens everywhere. I mean, it's... They really lay it on you when they want to. The world, whoever it is that's planning it. It's when your personal life is in the ash can, your career is, everything is.
Well, I remember you said, I think about the time when you were going to appear in Applause, you said you'd had 13 years of bad luck, and I mean really bad luck.
Well, my private life has certainly been a symphony of discord. Since Bogey's death, I would say. I mean, I don't think I've had... I don't know why. I mean, maybe I just attract disaster. I don't know. I hope not. But it seems to me that I have been unlucky. I think I have been. But I just... that's the way the world is. I mean, that's the way my world is. There's nothing I can do about it.
Well, you also said once that you thought you'd lived your life backwards, that at 20 you had all the things that most girls dream about, like a husband... wealth,
like husband,
wealth, fascinating life, and
yeah, right.
Now it's all gone and won't come back again. Well, that's a very pessimistic note.
I don't think it's pessimistic. I think it's true, actually. I mean, I think it's just those are the facts. I'm not particularly upset about it, but I say that usually, I mean, you work. You start off, when you're young, you don't give a damn. It's not that important what things you have, is it? You know, comforts and that kind of security you don't think of in terms of, you know, when you're 19 years old, it doesn't matter. But when you're older, you do think, gee, it'd be nice to have a little cushion, not to have to worry about. And, I mean, actually, I've had to work harder from Bogey's death on. Since and forever, I would say, than I did before. Just, I mean, for not only survival, but just, I mean, to live.
In the 1980s, Bacall was still gracing the talk shows, sharing stories about her fascinating past and her experience at the Warner Brothers studios.
I mean, I think that, I mean, Jack Warner's attitude was that actors were employees, and we did not consider that we were employees, and that he felt we should do as we were told. Unfortunately, he didn't have a lot of taste in choosing parts in films, so if you wanted to do something better, you were in trouble. What happened is that you got into arguments and you ended up on suspension and didn't work for a while. But even in spite of all of that, films then were wonderful, mostly terrific. And Warner Brothers actually produced some of the best films ever made. That will live forever, long after some of today's films will.
You don't think then that there was something to be said for this treatment of actors as if they were pieces of merchandise?
Oh, no. I don't think there's ever anything to be said for that. No, I don't think there was. But I think that there were a lot of tremendously talented people making films then. I mean, the focus was totally in California. It wasn't diffused by television, you see.
Is there, do you detect a great difference between then and now in the making of films? I mean, are you happy?
Well, there's a tremendous difference. Number one in cost, number one in the number of films, number one in the concentration of talent in one place. It doesn't exist anymore. Everyone is everywhere. I mean, you go where the work is. You seldom work where you live now. It's, there still are some very talented people. I mean, there are some young talented people in films, but I don't think as many. And they don't build stars to last.
And I think television has done that.
I'm sure that's
true. No offense.
No, quite. We're prepared to take the sticks. Because, in fact, it's very difficult to become a film star now, because people don't actually go out to movies, and you see people who are established feature players, but they don't become stars like they used to in the 40s and the 50s.
Well, they don't last, you see. Stars, to me, are people who last. Just to have your name over the title for 5 minutes is not a star, in my book, anyway. Yeah,
You were 19 when you were a star.
I was a wee girl.
Was it hard to handle?
Well, it would have been harder to handle had I not had Bogey, I'm sure. And also, I had a very solid upbringing, so that my feet were quite firmly planted on the ground. But it's pretty hard to keep your head when people say that you are the sun, the moon, and the stars.
Yeah.
All rolled into one.
Are you glad it happened to you then, rather than it would happen to you now?
Well, I'm glad it happened at all. I think I'm lucky that it happened at all. Of course, as I was told once by a man called Moss Hart, who was a playwright and fine playwright and director, after To Have and Have Not opened, he said, "You understand, of course, that you have nowhere to go but down." And he was absolutely right.
I don't think that's true.
No, but it is true, because if you are praised beyond your capabilities, which new people very often are, there's no way you can live up to that praise. It's out of all proportion to anyone's ability, to any reality.
Your original ambition was to work on the stage, and I think probably, maybe wrong, you prefer it to working in the movies, working on stage?
No, I just prefer working to not working.
Well, yes.
But I...
If you had a choice.
I don't... Well, if I had a choice, I'd do both. I'd do everything, because I think one has to, and I think one should. And each medium has something different to offer. But the theater, the thing that is the best thing about the theater is that it is happening then. It is now, it is live, and it is more in an actor's control than film is, which is not at all in an actor's control. Of course, the best thing about film is that you have a better life, because it's not that relentless 8 shows a week and usually 52 weeks a year. I mean, it's much...
You need stamina for the stage.
Yes, you do.
Right. You started out, well, your book says, by collaring producers and saying, use me, I'd be good in this kind of thing. Well, would you still do that?
I had a lot of nerve. Well, I've tried, but I'm so afraid of rejection, I can't.
As a young girl, you weren't afraid of the rejection. It wouldn't have mattered.
I don't think you think of it, you know. I thought, well, I had a hell of a lot of nerve, but I thought, I don't care, I'm just going to press on and do it. And what can they do? They can only say no. I suppose I would if I wanted to do something badly enough now, but I don't know, you get a little, one becomes very intimidated.
Really?
It's not easy.
One can't envisage you being intimidated.
Oh, you can't? Well, then you don't know human nature very well.
No, I'm well known for my lack of knowledge
of
human
nature. I'm sorry about that, but no, it's, to think that what one is on professionally is what one is, it's not, you know, that is not what we are. And to be, to present whatever persona I've presented over the years because of parts that I've played has nothing to do with the way I am. I mean, finally, you do begin to become that a little bit, you know. You are affected a little bit by it.
I'm interested. There's not a frail, weak, cowering woman, then, behind this facade.
No, but there's a very vulnerable, sensitive one. Yeah. Definitely.
Do you get offered many roles now? And what kind of roles
do you
like?
No, I'm not sure I'm crazy about that question. What kind of roles do you have in mind?
No, they don't allow me to offer anybody roles, even here on the BBC, but do you get offered interesting parts? Do you get offered many parts that you're interested in doing?
There are not many wonderful parts written for women, and there are not many terrible parts written for women. There are not many parts written for women of any age. It is very difficult to find anything that is worth doing. We keep hoping it will change, and maybe it will. I hope so. It's hard. It's very hard. That's another reason that I stay on the stage, because I find that there is better stuff to do on stage than there is in film.
Fortunately, notable roles kept coming, like the film Misery, and Barbara Streisand's The Mirror Has Two Faces, for which Bacall won a Best Actress Golden Globe Award and an Oscar nomination. Then, in 2000, she appeared on the show Scene by Scene, joining Mark Cousins to look back and critique her career so far.
I've got here the end of To Have and Have Not, where you do this wiggle.
Oh, you like that wiggle?
Which is one of the sexiest things in the movies.
It's so funny.
And Walter Brennan does the wee jig at the end.
Yeah, there you go.
It doesn't look planned or choreographed.
It wasn't.
Did Howard Hawks tell you?
No, I did it spontaneously when we were rehearsing, and Howard liked it and then wanted me to do it. Then I became a little self-conscious doing it. But because, you know, I studied dancing for 13 years. I wanted to be a dancer. So, and I, not that I considered that really dancing, but anytime I hear music, wiggling comes to mind.
So. Well, you wiggle like a dream, I can tell you that. I've got a bit of bad news for you. And the bad news is that I've got a clip here of Confidential.
Oh! Oh, I'm killing you.
I hate my own father for 1,000 reasons. Then I fall for a stupid idealistic fool who's trying to get himself killed. And you will be sooner or later. It's written all over you.
So pathetic. Look at him.
We shall see each other again before I leave. And celebrate. I do like you. Very much.
Stop lying.
Ooh.
It's not as bad as you think, that picture.
I have no idea what that scene is about. He was such a sweet man, such a lovely man.
And the newspaper said the bubble has burst on Bacall, the reviews were bad. Did it seriously damage your career?
Oh. I had to climb my way back up, I tell you, and you never get back. You never get back to that moment, you see. If I had had the care from Hawks that I might have had if he hadn't been such a macho man who was furious that I went off with Bogey, that movie never would have happened. The fact is that it hurt me a lot. I mean, all the critics who praised me, who said I was a combination of Garbo and Hepburn and Dan Dietrich and
Mae West.
Mae West, yes, and then I was this most exciting, brilliant, wonderful, funny, every compliment in the book to, we were wrong, send her back where she came from, disaster. Well, I mean, it was very hurtful.
Yeah.
But I was married to Bogey then. And my reaction was really healthy. I was not happy about it, but I didn't burst into tears about it, although it was hurtful.
Jumping ahead, you made the film The Fan in 1980.
I love The Fan.
And you play a stage actress who's stalked by this young man who's got pictures of the very young Lauren Bacall on his wall.
Yes.
You could say that it was quite a risky thing for you to do.
I know. It's very scary, all of that, because, you know, I have gotten a lot of in the past, and still I'm getting some nutty
nuts.
Mail. You know, yeah. There are nuts everywhere. And it is frightening, but it does exist, and it can exist.
Yeah. Coming up to date, you made The Murder Has Two Faces with director Barbara Streisand, and you got an Oscar nomination, which is...
That's as far as I'll go with that one.
Which is ironic in a way, because it wasn't a great picture, was it?
No. But it was a very good part. Streisand is a really good director, I have to tell you. She knows what the last shots were, she knows what shots are coming up, she knows what she needs.
Maybe she'll look back and turn into a pillar of salt.
She doesn't play the Hollywood game at all. She plays her own game, and she's got every right to do that in my book.
Alex looks nervous.
I guess they don't like her. I don't know what it is. The movie was not a popular movie.
It's time that we had another great Lauren Bacall film, isn't it?
But there hasn't been one of those ever in my book. A movie that I was it in. They don't write parts, you know. They don't write parts for women in general. That are terrific, and they don't
So unimaginative. They used to write, I mean, it's not Pedro Almodovar All About My Mother. Please God, if something like that would only come along.
But
I just hope somebody will one day.
Does Almodovar know that you would?
Yes, I've told him I love Pedro. I said, Pedro, I've got to be in your first English-speaking movie. I said, I will carry a tray. I don't care what I do. No, he's forgotten me already. He's made such a hit in this movie now.
That's your next great movie. I can't wait to see it. What would you do if all your films disappeared, if they were all white, if they didn't, you know, if nobody could see Big Sleep again, if nobody could see Designing Woman again?
That's life. What could I do? I tell you, I don't think of what happens after I'm gone. If things last, they last. You never know whether they last or not. And I don't do things for posterity anyway.
In 2009, Bacall received an honorary Academy Award in recognition of her central place in the golden age of motion pictures. She may not have sought out posterity, but she achieved it anyway.